my Netflix just for no reason pops up and they're like, are you sure you want to continue? Yes, no, at this point in the movie.
We're about to get really so racist on your ass.
Yes. Netflix just comes up and just goes, are you still going? Holy shit, bro. You want to take a break? You want to jack off to something or something?
Instead of yes, no, it's like, do you support Trump or don't you? If you support Trump, you're going to keep going.
God awful movie. Movies.
Welcome back to the Gamcast, where each week we sample another selection from Christian cinema because of a long series of bad life decisions. I'm your host, Noah Lugeons, and sitting 989 miles to my right is my good friend Heath Enright. Heath, welcome back.
Thank you. And by the way, in case anyone's wondering, this movie is why Netflix can charge that extra dollar starting next month. They earned it with big names like this. Booked it.
And sitting a slightly different 989 miles to my right is my bad friend Eli Vosnick. Eli, how are you this fine afternoon, sir?
I'm good. I was just valuing these last few moments that anybody can have doubts that I'm a racist. I'm really enjoying these first.
It's going to be a rough one. And that's because sitting 3,000 miles to my west in constant fear of a traffic stop is our special guest, masochist Ishmael Brown, host of the Angry Black Brant podcast. Ishmael, welcome to God Awful Movies.
What up? What up? Happy to be here around a bunch of white people and a Jew. Wait, Jews are white,
ooh,
right?
We got separated.
Yeah. Yeah, yeah, exactly.
Exactly.
Not clear.
I'm going to say the N-word.
He's got to take shit for all the Jewish stuff and the white stuff. Now, a word of warning, I'm going to be calling you Mr. Brown until you say, call me Ishmael. I'm just going to have to do that.
Ew. Oh, come on, man.
Make me feel like a Melvillionaire here. Come on. No, we'll do it off.
Just say it.
Call me Ishmael.
Oh, there it is.
Massive. All
right. Now do a flip.
I need to clean up a little bit here. So while I'm doing that, Heath, tell us, what will we be breaking down today?
All right. We watched Will a Man Rob God?
It's
a question movie. And as far as I can tell right now, the answer is pass. maybe we'll hash out the answer as we go. Kind of a thinker. Anyway, it's the story of a family and their extremely well-trafficked living room and how they keep giving away their money to a prosperity church and can't understand why they're like, Cutco knife royalties haven't arrived in the mail yet. So, a lot of fun.
And Eli, how bad was this movie?
Well, if some black people saw Birth of a Nation and thought, this isn't harmful enough, let's try it ourselves, then you will love this movie. This is a movie that's about giving your money to God when you don't have any money to give and how that is a good idea. That is the thesis of this movie.
It really is. Put it all on black.
We have watched so many of these fucking movies where I know I'm sitting there the whole time thinking, I can't believe this is the good guy. I can't believe this is the first time where it like surprised me when the good guy turned out to be the good guy. Like I really didn't even think a Christian movie would go this fucking far.
Yeah, it definitely. I because early on in the movie, there are characters that are like, why would you give your money away? This is all a con. This is all a huge fucking con. And then the movie's like, no, it's not, though. But it's not.
Yeah, all the way through, I thought it was actually, it was making these great points about why prosperity gospel is crap. The guy drives a Bentley and all. It's so weird that, and then it just, oh no, but God does help us out in the end kind of thing.
Yeah, right. In the end, they do return the fucking chain letter and they do get the good luck. It's insane.
They might as well have an African prince show up at the end and be like, I have that $20 million in gold.
You want to know what it reminds me of? It reminds me of American History X. Now, everyone likes this movie, but I'm like, fuck this movie, because the movie makes, when Ed Norton's character is racist, he makes these points that if somebody was on the fence, they'd say, yeah, fuck black people. And then at the end, he just ends up not being racist because he got raped by Aryan. He didn't take anything back.
No,
he didn't counter any of those points that sound kind of valid about black people.
No, because he's not racist anymore because Denzel Washington is nice to him after he gets raped by the Aryans.
Exactly. Yeah. He's a jive-talking black guy. Yeah, yeah.
So is there anything that you guys would like to nominate this one for being the best at being the worst at?
Ooh, ooh. Best worst character who didn't learn their fucking lines. The Pastor Sims.
The Pastor, yeah.
Uh-huh. Sims is knows ridiculous.
I know more of his lines than he does. He walks into every scene like he's in the actor's nightmare. He's like, yeah, I'm here to, then I will, god damn it. Like, he might as well call for line in this fucking movie. He is someone's cousin. I don't know whose, but he's someone's cousin.
At a certain point, he owed it to us to just call for a line, you know? Right. You stammer that long, just have someone tell you.
I didn't get why, like, first of all, there's hardly a crowd in the theater. No. So why not just not do it with a crowd so then you can do retakes?
That's right.
What the...
The crowd was a horrible idea.
The
yeah.
crowd was terrible. No thin people?
Awful.
You couldn't find an African American under 800 pounds for your movie?
Oh, well, and yeah, also you couldn't find like a shot that you had a tight shot of the crowd where you couldn't see six empty seats. Like it was like two people yeah. and then empty seats all around them or something.
Everyone in the crowd that they keep flashing to looks like a close up of a Whopper. It is fucking insane. I wouldn't show these people. I would show these people like a propaganda hate film.
And you know they paid them with food. Like they didn't pay to go there. That had to be what the draw was.
Yeah, no, it was right at the end of the buffet or something. Yeah.
For best worst, I'm gonna say best worst. Understanding of what computers are and do.
Oh.
They're just throwing around vague computer words the whole time that make no sense. Just bandwidth, modem, Y2K, glitch, router. They have no idea what's happening.
My best worst was, the aging of characters.
Oh, God.
Or the aging of actors, rather.
Yeah.
It's terrible.
Did they just, like, put baby powder on their facial hair and eyebrows?
Yes.
And then
yes.
just called it a day?
I think
yep,
so.
They did.
They were like, oh, did. Man, we ran out of budget. All I've got is this jar of baby powder. And then the three famous black people they got for this movie were just like, black don't crack? And they were like, yeah, black don't crack. Powder, powder, powder.
Like, why even gray it? Why just what? I don't know.
Especially when it didn't really like none of these characters seemed to it, like no one you never understood the relation of anyone to anyone, so nobody had to be old. Exactly right.
There are black actors in their 60s and 70s, right? Like those exist. I'm pretty sure. No,
yeah, it was actually the one old woman who was in it that they had to make everyone close to her age. I guess.
Oh,
I think she's the reason why everybody was old.
She was like 35. Yeah, she was pushing it. Yeah.
And yet for War Room, they couldn't find an actual old black woman. I was honestly going to go with best worst overall message. Do we get there? Or is this good most one. Damaging? Is it still give your rapist a second chance? Or is it this?
I feel like give your rapist a second chance is worse in the short term. But in the long term, you know, because it's give your rapist a second chance, not give your rapist a second chance and money you can't afford to give him. You know
right,
what I'm saying?
Right, so yeah,
it's
forever.
Up in the air.
Depends on the rapist.
Brock Lives Matter.
Context. Oh, God.
Dude. Oh, right. Yeah, right. I know it's only a matter of time before Eli starts asking Ishmael if his people really eat pig feet or something. So we're going to take a quick break to let him get that out of his system. And when we come back, we'll delve into all the apparently legal to say bullshit that is, will a man rob God? Okay, guys. Me and Heath are still getting set up here. So give me 1 second if you don't mind.
Okay. So, Ishmael, I have a question.
Don't do it.
No. Hear me out. Just hear
No. No, thank you.
Like you and I are friends.
This is the very first time we're speaking. Sorry.
Right, but we tweet, so like I was thinking.
Not a friendship.
Okay, so like I was thinking when we introduce you, I could be like, Ishmael,
I will karate chop you right where your head meets your motherfucking body, please. Saint, fucking terrible mistake, man.
So, as our Patreon supporters already know, last month we got an offer to put advertising on the show. And while this wasn't the first such offer, it was by far the best. So we asked our financial supporters and our Facebook fans how they'd feel about putting ads on the show, and we got 100% positive response. That being said, we did get a lot of requests for more details, so we thought we'd tackle a few of those questions today.
For example, I'll fuck your mouth with a razor scooter.
Oh, do it. Do Great. It. I'm going to fill my mouth with caviar first. Wait a second. Wait a second.
I fucking will. Seriously.
Guys, guys.
What? I will.
All right.
This is exactly what people are worried about. Look, we're taking on these ads for our listeners. The ad revenue is going to pay for us to do the GAM Live tour next year, to go to more conventions, produce more books, more videos, and more overall content for the fans. Not to buy fur coats in July. Where the hell did you even get that?
I made it out of mink.
Yeah, I just took my shirt off because it was hot.
Yeah, he's not a coat.
I'm doing the heartfelt, we're not going to change thing here, guys. Just give me a minute.
Yeah, speaking of minute, you know what saves me a minute? Casper mattresses. Oh, sleep so sweet, you'll probably die.
Living Waters like Church. That. Services Sunday at 3 and 8 p.m.
No, this is what I'm talking about. Obviously, we're not going to advertise for anything we don't stand for, and we're not going to allow the endorsements to change the content of the show. Come on, guys.
Brought to you by the KKK.
No, it's
not. Yeah, a group so loyal, you'll probably die.
Ooh, this is good. I want double.
I hate both of you. And finally, a reminder that the content of the show isn't going to change. The show is still us, and none of our advertisers are going to have a say on what we do and don't say about puppy sodomy. And of course, if you can't handle the idea of listening to and or fast-forwarding through the ads on the show, you can always get an ad-free edition of every episode by becoming a per-episode donor at patreon.com/godawful.
I'm jealous. Heath's is thicker than mine.
My skin is always wet, though. That's...
Oh.
Are those fish in your shoes?
Yeah. Fish shoes.
You can tell by the way I got fish in my shoes that I have Patreon advertisers now. Advertising. KKK. Living Waters. Something about California.
KKK.
Terry Mashman. Casper Mattress.
I'm just going to send that to Ishmael. I'm just going to play him and clip that off. This is what they were saying when you left, bro.
Ku Klux Klan.
All right, sorry.
And we're back for the breakdown, and we're going to start this movie off with the strangest motley crew of discordant logos you can imagine, and then it's on to the Windows Movie Maker 94 opening credits sequence.
Right, so this is Phase 4 films, and I'm assuming Phase 1 was Jim Crow. I don't know what the other... Phase 2 is redlining, Phase 3 is broken windows policing, and Phase 4 is this movie, right? I'm trying to...
None of this is funny.
No, not at all.
I'm regretting coming on here. Really.
You're only starting to regret coming on here, bro. Only getting it started. Now, and my music note, unfortunately, here was... Yeah, this is really good music, actually, for the start.
Yeah,
damn it.
My music note was, yeah, black people are better at music than us. It's true. It's true.
My music note was, I wish Ishmael could see me dancing to this opening music. I feel like it would make him feel better about this movie.
Hey, Ishmael, I should get points. Mine was the only one that wasn't even subtly racist. I was
exactly. I'm
mine was very clearly pro, what, anti-white. I had an anti-white message. White lives don't matter.
Only black lives matter.
Only the black ones.
Whatever. I'm getting more black friend points than any of you guys.
Ooh, are we doing a tally at the end of the show?
Yes. Oh, absolutely. I'm
you can award it to one of us like Andy does on his show. He's a murderer. He's a murderer rapist.
He's talking about Andy Wilson, not you, Ishmael.
Yeah. Oh, I know. Andy Wilson, the child murderer or something, right?
Yeah. Is that what he does? I hear a lot of rumors. I've heard that from multiple sources. So
that's what he does in between episodes. Serial killing string.
That's why it takes so long, I guess. Now, I do want to say the one good thing about these credits, I would fuck this entire cast except the guy in the glasses.
Yeah, LaTanya Potts, who cast this movie, killed it. There are some good-looking people,
yes.
Including I'd fuck Uncle E.
I don't know about that.
See, I think what's going on here is, because I wouldn't fuck anybody in here. Maybe Robin Givens back
yes.
in the day.
Yes.
But I think what you guys, what's going on is, so you'd say you'd fuck everyone, and I think that has so much about the least amount of people that you have exposure to. Mm-hmm. Because I used to hang out at, like, the Hillel house at my college, and, like, all of my Jewish friends were confused when I was like, oh, I'd fuck that white, big-nosed Jewish chick, and her. And my boy Moishe would be like, what? Why would you? She's terrible, and her family has only funded one of our lox and bagel Sunday brunches. Oh. And I'm like, fuck you, Moishe.
I'm just picturing Ishmael just rolling up and her being like, hands up, oh God, take it. I don't know, man. I'm trying to talk to these girls. They keep throwing their purse at me and running away. Why did everyone buy that pink mace that doesn't work?
Shit. Yeah, that's why I never fucked a Jewish chick. That's why.
We're going to change that. You and me. Reason Rally 2020.
All I'm going to say, Eli, is so far I haven't made any big nose jokes. I'm winning when it comes to Jew friend points today. So we open this goddamn monstrosity of a film with, like, you think our show's racist. The opening line is a black man looking at his TV saying, yeah, you tell him, Obama. By now, I thought you'd have barbecue on the front lawn and Domino's in the back. I'm sorry, well, Ishmael, can I quote that? Is that okay for a white man to quote?
Yeah.
I wrote in my notes, that's like Trump got to write one line of this
right.
movie.
Well, I'm confused, though. Can you not barbecue on the front yard and play dominoes in the back right now in the United States? Is that a prop? Or was is that like a sex thing I haven't heard of, maybe?
No, I was... just amazed that they opened it just making fun of black people. Like, I didn't get it. I'm like, wait, do you guys know you're supposed to, like, give a fuck about your characters and show them in a good light? That, I guess they think that's comedy. Let me do some minstrel show type of thing and then people will find that shit funny. I was amazed that that's how it opened.
Yeah. Yeah, and it's all downhill from here.
I've heard minstrel shows aren't racist. I heard Eli do an appearance. He debated somebody. Apparently, they're not. I don't know. Is that true?
Good job.
Yeah, minstrel shows, the crows from Dumbo.
Not racist at all. Okay, awesome. Good.
Good.
That's
to
locked
know.
In.
Yeah. So, and I immediately wanted to start taking back all the nice stuff I had to say about the music here because, okay, so we got this guy and he's smoking cigarettes and he's eating tacos and he's watching TV and then the old lady comes and he hides the cigarette and she starts fighting with him about whether he was smoking and the music behind this scene now is a cartoon mouse sneaking theme.
Yeah, I wrote exactly. That somewhere later. That comes back a lot. Pretty much every time Uncle
yes.
E and yep. Mama Jean talk, it becomes boing, 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 boom, boom, boing, boom, boom, boing, boom, boom, boing, boing.
Right.
Yes. It's Home Alone. It's Home Alone. Yes. Devious Kevin McAllister.
Yes. Yeah, exactly. Exactly.
And that's when we're introduced to a character named Pookie. Now, here's the thing. We spend a lot of time on this show talking about the things that white people name their black characters in Christian movies, but if you're gonna do it to yourselves, it's hard to say on the back end. You know, when you get to name the characters and you name someone Pookie, it's very hard for me to get on side later on when the guys who make Fireproof also name you Easy E or
right,
Murder
right.
Face
or T-Dog or T-Bone. Or, yeah, I'm they just hurt my heart with that. I'm like, what are you doing? What are you doing? I complain about that. I stopped watching The Walking Dead because a black guy was like T-Bone or T-Dog. I was like, fuck this show. I'm not sitting through this. And then here they go with fucking Pookie. I'm black and I never fucking, I don't have anyone named Pookie in my goddamn family.
No Pookies in your life.
At least Pookie had more than one letter. It wasn't just like P.
Yeah, so we did have nice. Uncle E though. So the old lady and Uncle E are talking and four people walk in, Pookie, Stacy, Natalie, and Stacy's ass. And this is the first time that we have to stop here and say to ourselves, like, whose home is this? Who lives yes. here? Who doesn't? Who are these people to one another? This question will be omnipresent in this movie.
Yeah, these questions get answered slowly like the people who were satisfied with Lost. Like, I feel like I knew what happened in this movie, but I'm not sure.
Yeah, now, we should mention at this point, by the way, of course, that this is a play that's being shot live. Obviously, we've given that away with the audience. It will all take place on the same set. This one set of this living room is where the entire thing is going to take place, even when that makes no fucking sense.
With a deeply underused kitchen. Like, the set, really, they have one set and they use half of it. They could have had a sofa. They could have done Arthur Miller's original Death of a Salesman, where it's just a head with the one chair in the center, and they would have pretty much used the same amount of fucking furniture for this film. It's crazy.
Yeah.
But what we learn in this scene that's important because everyone's going to repeat it throughout the movie until about 30 seconds before the end is that Mama Jean and her husband Charlie go to a different temple.
A Baptist church, uh-huh.
Right. And the younger people whose names I will not ever learn. But one of them is Corey.
Corey, Pookie, Natalie, and Stacy. You're racist.
Corey, Pookie, Natalie.
Those are
Natalie
normal names. This is the first time we've ever had black people with normal names, and you can't remember them.
Three out of four of them are normal names. They're still
Pookie.
Well,
still Pookie, yeah.
Still Pookie.
That brings the average down to 0.3, yeah.
Right. They have begun to go to a prosperity ministry, and Mama Jean does not approve.
No. Also, the other very important thing we learn here is that Uncle E has a bowel problem of some sort and has to run off to take a shit constantly, which is hilarious.
What happens in the writer's room where the guy's like, okay, guys, we need a little bit of comedy. What if Uncle E has terrible, terrible Crohn's disease and just continually shits his pants? And they were like, I love it. Let's give one of our characters undiagnosed colon cancer just in case this prosperity ministry movie gets too heavy.
Right.
And that is how Uncle E will be used, by the way. They yep. will come in, be like, you know, you really should be giving all the money you can't afford to give to your preacher. And then Uncle E comes in and he's like, hey, everybody, I just jerked off into this chicken and I'm still going to eat it.
Yeah, I didn't get the usage of him and the husband, who we haven't met yet.
No.
But I'm like, why couldn't that be one character?
Right, yeah,
like,
right.
What's going on?
There's no fucking reason. I don't know. So now we're going to meet Corey. This is Darius McCrary. And he comes into a fucking any character on a Fox show level round of applause. So we can talk more about this faith temple prosperity gospel thing.
Yeah. Woo! Eddie Winslow, Family Matters. Yeah.
Oh.
Thank you, Heath. He said Darius McCrary as if that would have been enough for people to know. You know? It's Eddie from Family.
It's Eddie Winslow.
I actually thought
yes.
it was. See, I'm the racist one because I thought for a second it was Malcolm Jamal Warner.
All the people from the 80s look the same. Yeah. So basically, what we're getting here is the older people in the room arguing with the younger people in the room about whether the prosperity gospel thing is good. Now, here's the thing. The old lady, Mama Jean, in the movie keeps saying, you kids need to come back to such and such Southern Baptist church. And everybody's like, no, Mom, we're going to this prosperity gospel where the pastor drives a Bentley. I was absolutely certain through this entire fucking movie that the pastor was the guy robbing God because he had the fucking Bentley. And that in the end, they were all going to go back to the Southern Baptist church. I was certain
exactly.
that's the movie we were watching.
Spoilers, it's the opposite.
It's pro Creflo Dollar. This is pro Creflo Dollar.
They sit around for like 5 minutes at a time and just shit on the whole prosperity idea.
Yeah.
They just tear it to pieces.
Yeah.
The uncle makes valid points about him being a pimp and everything.
Right.
Well, wait.
Right.
Let's talk about the uncle's quote unquote points. Because the uncle he comes out and he's like, he's a pimp. He's a P-I-M-P. All preachers are pimps. And the audience did not like that, by the way. When he said all preachers are pimps, the audience was like, mm-mm.
Yeah, they were starting to clap up till then, and then, whoa.
Right.
I wanted somebody to yell out, not my pastor.
And then what happens is, he explains that all pastors are pimps, and then, and I'm not making this up, he does a little dance. When he's done making his point, he does
a little jig
for us.
Yeah. He's the minstrel show character. He does it. I had a feeling him and the cousin or the guy with the high pants or whatever. I think those two are comedians and they're doing like their crappy bits on stage.
They're doing Amos and Andy.
It just comes off like a bad comedy bit.
Mm-hmm. No, horrible. I think you're exactly right. I think that's exactly it. And at that moment, I wanted so bad to find out that a white man wrote this movie.
Me too. A white man wrote it. I swore. I'm like,
for the sake of my race.
Oh my God.
I also, it's such a tiny thing in the sea of a shit show of this movie, but this is where Mama Jean's counter argument to the prosperity minstrel, or the prosperity minstrel.
No, you had it right accidentally.
Yeah. Her counterpoint is that if God wants people to be saved, he'll see that they're saved. He doesn't need money. And that also means that if God doesn't want people to be saved, he's just like, fuck that guy. He's going to burn in hell forever, even though I could totally help, and I won't.
Yeah, we exactly. call that Allah-ing.
Another thing that struck me the second time I watched this was, but I wanted someone to say, but wait, what's the difference between your church except for your preacher doesn't drive a Bentley.
Yeah,
I mean,
right.
Isn't that the only difference?
Your preacher wants a Bentley.
They both tithe.
Yeah, well, exactly. Exactly. And that's what fucked me up about this whole thing. It's like, yes, Mama Jean is right. Your church is bullshit, but that's just by default. You know, you can fill in the blank on the church. It's like a Mad Lib. And then also, this is where we get like tangentially introduced to the character of D Money.
Again, your movie. You didn't need to name him D Money. He didn't need
to
be named
D Money again.
The rapper.
Yeah, D Money was the rapper. So they see him on TV. They're like, "Hey, that's D Money on TV."
That's right.
Yeah, and they're like, and I guess he got famous by acting like a heathen. So even though he's a gazillionaire, they don't really talk much to him.
Well, they want us to say like, "Oh, he's running the dope game." That gets brought up a couple of times. So we're supposed to believe that he's a multi-platinum selling rapper and drug dealer.
Yeah, like sells a little weed on the side. Yeah, exactly.
Yeah, calls a number and he's like, I'm sorry, are you a multi-platinum? That's like if Jay-Z showed up and was like, look, you want this 8-ball or not? And it's like, I guess so. How's Beyonce? I don't have time for this, man. All right, fine.
I did not get that at all. I was like, I even said when they reveal it, I'm thinking, wait, can't you just say his music is of the devil and leave it at that? You don't need to make him a friggin' drug dealer.
It's just so
you can say you glorify
bizarre.
Stuff we don't believe in. What?
Yeah,
like you said, it's my movie, it's our movie. What are we doing here? Jesus.
Right. No, he's triple platinum and he's still selling drugs. He's a method man. He's a method man.
Oh, I see.
And what we learn here is that what Stacy brings up is Stacy says, "How come you still live on this soundstage if your son's a famous rapper?" Right. To which right. Mama Jean responds, knock, knock. Oh, Heath, do this with me. Knock, knock.
Who's there?
I don't know. Go home and find out. And the audience in this theater
yes.
reacts like you showed them all a magic trick. They're just like, I have
Oh my gosh.
If you showed that to an audience of white people, there would have just been hands raised. Like, everyone would have been, excuse me, so sorry, what is that? I don't understand.
No, you gotta make it about race. Can't it be about Christians or something? Say audience of atheists. Say audience of atheists, you asshole.
And if that wasn't enough to kill this fucking audience, Uncle E's gotta poop again. Like, act one, we get twice him storming out. We're supposed to laugh at his fucking bowel issues, yeah.
Lots of people shit twice in 10 minutes without colon cancer, right? I'm hoping. Is that?
Mostly, yeah. All the time, bro.
Getting ready for the live show.
But this is also where we learn, okay, so that Mama Jean, like the rapper D Money, who is a gazillionaire, wants to give her more money and move her into a nicer house, but she won't take it because it's the devil's money. She chooses to be poor. That's why mm-hmm. black people are very often poor, is because they choose not to take the devil's money.
Yeah, and the thing is, that set's not a bad set. They kept saying the house was so bad. First of all, it has floors in it. I grew up poor in a tiny freaking apartment and slept on a couch while my sister and mother slept in the next room. This isn't even a bad house. Like, get a worse looking set, you idiots. Yeah. Like,
some odd couple was like done with their set and they were like, we'll take it.
Yeah.
You done with that set? I mean, yeah, we're done with it. We're going to break it down. Don't need to break it down. No, use it for our show. Really. Just put some Afghan blankets on the back and,
it's perfect for every single scene we wrote, actually. So, this is great.
Even the scenes that should definitely be happening at work.
Yes.
And then, Natalie and Mama Jean are fighting about the prosperity minstrel. I'm going to say that over and over again. Prosperity thing. They keep fighting over it. And then Natalie calls Mama Jean a fool.
Mm-hmm.
And
mm-hmm.
there is a moment here where you are what I was 100% certain in my heart. Mama Jean was going to beat the shit out of Natalie live on stage.
Certainly how they played it. Yeah.
Yeah. When I saw that, I'm like, okay, so they want us to know the mother used to be very fucking abusive.
Yeah. Yes.
That type of shit lets you know her mother has beat her fucking ass.
Well, her reaction, yeah, she just like falls limp and just like starts to shake and shit. And
yeah, her eyes are fluttering like she's trying not to pass out. Like that's how frightened she is. Yeah.
And it's comedy. It's supposed to be, we as an audience are supposed to be like, uh-oh, she's going to abuse her child. Honestly, you might as well play Yakety Sax during the rape scene in True West. Like that's... how fucking crazy this play
is. But I can't lie. The black Christians, I'm sure they're like, mm-hmm, you better not talk back. She brought you in this world. She could take you out. So right. I'm sure the audience was right on board with that.
Yeah,
that grows more ironic the more people accuse Bill Cosby of rape. I like that sentence. More people.
Bill Cosby, that blind bastard. So did you hear Bill Cosby's blind now?
Yep. Oh, yeah, yeah, yeah. Yeah.
Even though he's just doing the mobster style tactic, you know, when the old mobster gets caught and they're bringing him to court. So he has all these ailments to stop him.
Right, from, right. He has to have an oxygen tank with him. Yeah.
I assumed he was just having a meeting with a lawyer somewhere. And he was like, look, if I'm lying, may God strike me blind. Whoop! He turned out the lights. Not funny, guys.
Fuck.
I think he just masturbated on a passed out woman too many times. Isn't that how it goes? Yes. That's how you go blind. I heard that's how you go blind.
Check his palms. Yeah,
check his hairy palms. Yep. So,
if you're not picturing Bill Cosby with afros on his palms, you're not the audience we know enough.
So now Daddy gets home, which is the first time we really have to dig in and ask ourselves, who the fuck are all these people? I thought Uncle E was the patriarch in this situation, but no, Daddy is.
Yeah.
And he's pretty bummed.
And Dad looks like he forgot to become Suge Knight. That's what
he's like. He's like the Bruce Wayne to Suge Knight. Yeah, exactly. So apparently Dad's in trouble because he's been out gambling again. So Mama Jean clears the room so that they can have a discussion about this.
Well, she cleared the room before she knew he was gambling. She just told, oh, the father walks in, everybody leave. I was like, wait, why is everyone leaving? I don't get what. And then she sits him down and it's like, have you been gambling again? And that's all she says. And he breaks down from that. Yeah, you got me. Like, yes. No, just say no.
At least try no. See how that works.
Right. And she says, why couldn't you just, like, invest this money instead of gambling it? And, well, that's the – because that's a false dichotomy, it's gambling.
Yeah. Shouldn't it be, why couldn't you use the money to pay our bills? And yeah. Then you wouldn't have to gamble to make more money?
So much more sense.
What's crazy about that is that it like, equates – gambling and investment, like gambling's just a worse kind of investment.
Yeah, right, exactly.
It's just like, I don't know, should we go with these mutual bonds or the craps table? I'm trying to figure out.
Lotto tickets. Let's get lotto tickets. Let's diversify.
Yeah, and I wondered about that because a lot of most churches I've ever been to, if not all, black churches are in other churches too, but are against gambling and they're against lotto playing. And I started to wonder, shouldn't they be against investment as well? Because isn't that a form of gambling?
Yeah,
very right, much right. Exactly a form of gambling. Yes. Yeah.
So I guess now that scene's over or whatever, but we couldn't tell if they didn't black the screen out and bring it back because the entire movie takes place in the same fucking set. So now we cut to the same place we already were, where the human sphincter and the gay guy are playing chess incorrectly as hell.
That board could not be less set up for chess.
No, the chess is brutal. Yeah, like, well, first of all, the queen starts on its own color. They already have that wrong. And also, apparently, Uncle E lost his king earlier in the game. Not sure how that happened.
Strategic
and,
sacrifice.
And I guess Pookie castled his bishop and knight at some point. And now he has two black bishops. It's fine.
I honestly think this was written by someone who's an atheist, but they want to sell it to Christian people. So they're just, the guy who wrote it is making fun of these. Because what about them shows they would even play chess? And does no one know how to set? Wouldn't any stage guy say, well, let's at least set up the chessboard because we're going to put the camera on it. Let's make it look real. And just one guy who knows chess, put the pieces out. It's not like we got to watch them play. I really think someone who hates prosperity gospels and hates just religion in general wrote this. I was like, I'm going to make fun of these motherfuckers for the whole shit. And at the end, I'm going to give them a little win. And then I'm going to make some dough.
If you told me this entire movie was made sarcastically by a racist atheist, I'd be like, makes sense. Makes yep, sense.
Totally.
If like you gave me 8 shots of Jameson and I was like, I got a fucking movie for them. I got a movie they can do. Oh, they'll love this. And then Uncle E shits his pants and Pookie's like, oh no, Mother, we're sick. They'll fucking love it. Write it down.
Hey, Eli, did I notice you say for them and then was about to say something else and didn't want to finish for them again? Because you doubled up on for them. That seemed kind of weird.
What do you mean, them people?
For them nice black people.
Neighbors. I was going to say Neighbors. So, yeah, so during the triple jump on the chessboard or whatever, these two men see Beyonce on TV, and since they're black men, that means everything must stop. I'm sorry. Since they're men, that means everything must stop.
Well, and while they're doing this excellent fucking Chaplin-esque comedy, they cut to an audience member not laughing.
No, no, just some not, bored just not fat laughing, girl.
Looking upset. Like, yeah. I don't want to be here.
Yeah, she looks like the situation just told a joke at a roast. Like, why show that? Don't show her there.
It's so bad.
Why would you use that? That's what I mean.
Right.
There's no way somebody who put this together is for this movie. Right. I said, and then the guy does, which is obviously a bad comedy routine. That's what these two guys do. He does the walking around, and it's like I didn't look him up, but I will not be surprised if he's some failed comedian.
Yeah.
Oh yeah. Absolutely. No, I think you absolutely nailed that. So yeah, he does his routine about how hot Beyonce is and how if only he could, he had more money, she would fuck him.
Hey, but now we have a new goal on Patreon.
He also throws in a Donald Trump joke, which was lovely. And my note here was, but black people make fun of Donald Trump like this. And it was a terrible joke.
And the audience loved it. They loved it.
His head does look like a chinchilla. Yeah.
And the thing about the Donald Trump joke, you want to know what's funny? This movie's from motherfucking 2013. He's not even running for president. He's not even topical.
Yeah, right.
Where did Donald Trump joke come from? Why Donald Trump? Jesus.
But he cheats at chess and Pookie notices.
Mm-hmm.
And so he pulls a banana out of his pocket.
Oh my God.
I don't understand. This is one of the things that I didn't understand at all. Like, I was just confused and afraid. He pulls a banana out of his pocket and challenges Uncle E to a banana fight outside. Ishmael, what is a banana fight?
No, stop acting like everything in this damn movie relates to black people. It could just be a bad writer, you bastard. How about we watch Matrix 3 and I start saying, what's wrong with you white people? Why? What does that mean?
Matrix is a sci-fi movie. People are not supposed to watch. This is a realist play. It's not surreal. Nobody walks up a wall in this movie.
And Denzel Washington was in The Matrix 3. Come on.
Yo, that was the worst banana. It wasn't just banana fight. He pretended the banana was a gun.
Yes.
And he was like, oh, my banana clipped something. And the audience loved it.
Oh, fucking God. Yeah, I thought he was threatening to anally penetrate him. And I'm like, okay, right? I mean, if we got to watch this movie, let's watch this dude fucking with a banana.
And
but
those two are fucking too. So you know that.
Yeah.
Bachelors always hanging out together.
And I just want to emphasize to the audience here that, yes, in this movie, a character suddenly, for no reason, pulls a banana out of his pocket to threaten. This banana had not been introduced to the movie. This banana will never come back. A man just is supposed to, we're just supposed to believe that he had a banana in his pocket, threatens to shoot someone with it, and then we're just supposed to laugh and move on.
That guy only does his skits. You notice, like, the first one, we didn't even talk about the, oh, this is my church capri pants. First of all, that makes no sense. It's dumb. All you did was pull your pants up. He is clearly just doing stupid. Right. He is the funniest guy they know. Like, he might be naturally funny. I don't believe it, but so they're like, oh, we got to get him in this play. We don't even need to write no line for him. You just let him create. He's going to create on stage.
Yeah. I think you might be right. So Uncle Lee says, yeah, let's go outside and have a banana fight or whatever. But as soon as Pookie gets out the door, he closes it. And since we don't know if Pookie lives here or not, we don't really know how to react to that. But at any rate, and so there's knocking on the door. And I guess they thought they were going for that classic, oh, the person who I just locked out, I assume that's him knocking, so I'm reacting to that when it's actually somebody different. But they fucked it up. And the Uncle Lee is just like, oh, I thought you were someone else, but clearly you're not.
Yeah, I didn't get, and where'd Pookie go? Did he fall through some black hole? Is he still walking with the banana?
Why's it gotta be a black hole, Ishmael? All holes matter.
Because it's larger than an average hole.
Oh, well done, sir. So, yeah, but this is where we meet Pastor Sims. Now, we haven't talked about how bad the acting is in this movie yet, and that's not because the acting hasn't been bad. We were saving it for when Pastor Sims shows up.
Yeah, I mean, the acting has at least been, shall we say, lively, but Pastor Sims looks like he was handed his script backstage, and they were like, you got it, right? And he was like, this is an awful lot of lines. They were like, go, 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 go!
Yeah, and he's like, he's clearly getting physical cues from his stage mom in the wings, and he's just not getting it. He's trying.
I honestly think he's not an actor. He's an actual pastor. Because he didn't belong on that stage. And they didn't belong either, but he really didn't belong on it.
Oh, terrible. There were like four different times where he ends a sentence and the other actors clearly like whispering under their breath, like, I'm not talking yet because you still have another sentence. You still have another sentence. Just go.
Right. Now that's what's going on in this scene though. We have to meet Pastor Sims so that Uncle E can have a conversation with him where he's basically like, man, what is this bullshit? You say God, God, Jesus, Jesus, and then you drive around in a Bentley. Now, because ultimately this character will turn out to be the good guy, they don't dig all that deeply into it, but they don't shy away from it much either, enough so that at this point I still thought that guy was going to turn out to be the bad guy.
Yeah, I had no idea who to root for. This was like watching a couple of homeless guys fight because they were both black.
Boo, I want to distance myself from Eli right here.
And a cop just comes and shoots them both.
Yeah. They were clearly a danger to somebody.
And edit point.
So, and of course, my music note here is maybe if all the fleas work together, they can save Jerry. But this is also where Mom comes in so that the pastor can now be the second worst actor on the stage, I think. She's pretty brutal. And now the pastor says to him, like, hey, if you guys need financial help, all you have to do is ask, you know, and, you know, one day, and perhaps that day will never come, I may have to ask a favor of you.
Right. And she's like, I don't want to ask money from you. We don't need your money. You look at you with your fine clothes. And this character is dressed head to toe from like the bargain section of H&M. He is not wearing fine. He's wearing a vest. Did they mean vest?
Yeah, I think that's why she had to say it. It's like, we're pretending he's wearing fine clothes, y'all. For the movie, you got to pretend. Yeah.
It's that great rule of cinema, tell, don't show.
Exactly.
And I got to say, she's offended when he says, when she tells him, like, oh, my kids, I assume are her kids who may be dating or maybe brother and sister, are poor. And he's like, oh, I can probably help them, have them come down and sign papers. And she's so offended.
Right.
As if, like, like, first of all, okay, fuck tithing. But if the place you tithe to says, no, we'll give you money, go get that fucking money.
That's great.
About?
Yeah. Right.
Just write your name on the paper and get the money. Why is this a problem?
Yeah, exactly. He can't just give money out without accounting for it. Like, yeah, sign a fucking paper, said I gave it to you.
Well, the subtitle of this entire film could be, man, do I need money? No, not that money. Yeah. Right. Because this movie is a series of people just like, oh, I need to hide this leprechaun gold. Do you want some of it? Leprechauns are Irish, and I'm not into the... Ixnay on the Irish, Ray.
Smelling like whiskey, so...
I'm officially offended by this. This is a racist show you guys are doing.
You're the Mike Kaplan of this podcast.
Whatever you, Mick.
It's McCaw. You know, you can't say that.
With an H, right?
You got to say it with an H. You got it.
All right, so let's move on, please. So the pastor here, of course, and this, and again, this, if this movie was sane, this could have been a great and poignant moment where they're like, man, how do you sleep at night knowing that none of the people you minister to are as wealthy as you? None of the people who are giving you money can afford to do it. And he's like, I sleep really well because all bullshit is equally bullshit, I guess. That's essentially his argument.
Yeah, listening to his argument, he's saying, oh, I didn't believe in this either, but look how much money I got. Yeah, from the people you were saying will get rich.
Well, right. Such a,
like, how do people not see that connection? He's getting rich because they see the pastor as an example of how you can make money, but he's making money from you giving him fucking money.
Right, like, the president of Amway is fucking loaded.
Right. It worked out really well for Bernie Madoff.
Yeah, exactly.
This movie might as well be called Bernie Madoff and You.
And I love this bit too, because okay, first of all, I have to point out that the pastor literally upstages himself. in this scene. He steps so far forward that he has to keep turning around to address the actress that he's talking to.
I thought he was going to lie on his back or do a bridge at one point so he could talk to the other character.
Oh, my God.
But then he, like, gives this whole, like, prosperity gospel thing or whatever, and Uncle E decides to fuck with him. He's like, man, that was so good. I'm going to give you money. And he goes to reach in his pocket, and it's just a joke, but he's not going, but I'm not going to. But they actually have the pastor walk over and hold his hands out for the money.
What the Every time you think this character isn't about to take money from somebody, he tries to take money from someone. It's fucking insane.
It gets so much worse.
I'm going back to my theory that he's not an actor, he's a pastor, and that's instinctive. They probably wrote his character better, and he wasn't supposed to want the money, and he was supposed to defend it better, but he forgot the lines, and that's what's going on right now.
Yeah, right.
He's just on autopilot.
Yeah, it's like ringing a bell, man. I start to salivate. So, and then because Uncle E just mopped the floor with this wicked ass preacher who's supposed to be the good guy, I guess to reinforce that he's the bad guy, we have to see him going off to the strip club to see Big Booty Bonita.
Yes, Big Booty Bonita is doing a fundraiser.
Yes.
Yeah, what? And you want to know what else was weird? The mother totally co-signed it. She was laughing and like, oh, you going to see Big Booty Bonita? Like, yeah. I thought she would have been like, that's not Christ. Like, that's not. Nope. I swear they forget how they're supposed to act and they just start doing normal shit.
Yeah, she's like, say hi to.
Oh, you going to see Big Booty Bonita? Get your shit off, daddy.
Yeah, she's like, oh, say hi to Bonita for me. And she's like, I will. You'll see her at church on Sunday, but I'll say hi.
Exactly.
Okay, tell her to be late for my shift tomorrow. It's cool.
Yeah, I always like that the pastor. I mean, not the pastor, the uncle's like, oh, I'm going to give you some money. This dude is like a homeless guy living on a couch. Like, the pastor should have been like, motherfucker, from you? What are you talking about? You got a job?
Yes, he should have been. Yes. He very much should have been. And again, we'll come back to that. So now we have to introduce another undercurrent, probably the most bizarre and stupid undercurrent of this movie. So this is where Natalie shows up. Natalie is crazy fucking hot. I had to pause the movie for a few minutes every time she shows up. But she's nervous because her boss is coming to her house and she's not ready. She was supposed to fix the glitch in the computer bug data router. And
yeah, so let's break this down because we do eventually find out what this is. We're supposed to believe that this character who is impoverished and lives in a family with her mother, her father, her brother, Pookie, who she may be related to, and her uncle, and has constant bill problems, works for a company that redesigns systems for Microsoft.
Yep. That's what she does.
Not only is that not a one-person project, but that is not a project you do from home on your 1997 Dell computer, which is what she will use
throughout.
No one
had a Mac. Nobody there had a decent-looking computer.
Right. And the exact words, she's trying to figure out that computer glitch.
Yep.
That's as detailed as they get. It's like the punch cards are jammed. Yes. Or like the abacus is stuck. You know, like what?
The vacuum tubes are full. Yeah. This is a very fundamental part of this movie. It's going to come back over and over again, and it never gets described as anything more specific than the glitch in the computer program. Yeah. That's it.
Right. The system. She's supposed to fix the glitch in
that's,
the system.
Well, yeah, right, yeah. But they figure out what the problem is right here in this scene, so they don't need our help. Apparently, the problem is that mom's not tithing.
Mom's a god robber,
that's
you guys.
That's the fucking term they use. They go, oh, mom, you're a god robber.
But mom is very offended to be called a god robber, and especially because Natalie points out that the fact that she's a god robber is probably why the family is cursed. And if you're thinking to yourself, hey, that's going to get disproven because that's a crazy thing to say, A, to your mother, B, in the universe that exists. No, the family is actually cursed. She is actually a god robber.
The actual fucking line is, when you rob God, you are cursed with a curse. That's an actual line from the movie. amazing.
You curse. Like, and shouldn't the mother be like, "Then bitch, get out my house. What are you talking about? If I'm cursed, get the fuck out of here. Right. You're cursed with bad computer programming skills, motherfucker. Get out of my face." Like, and doesn't the daughter say something like, "I don't give to man," because she's like, "Why give it to?"
Yeah,
because they find out they're still tied. They're mailing it in, right?
Right.
And she says, "Why give it to him?" She's like, "Oh, we don't give to man. We just give because we give and we're giving to." Then give to a fucking charity. I immediately was like, "Then why give it to the pastor with the Bentley if you're not really giving it to him?"
Right.
Give it to some fucking charity then.
Yeah.
Yeah. Exactly. The daughter says, "We don't tithe to the pastor. We tithe to the Lord. He just." Shares a bank account with the pastor, so it makes it easy, and you send it to them. Easy, pastor, pray pal, whatever.
So apparently now Uncle E is back from his 8-second lap dance, because they're not even paying attention. He just left, and now he's coming back. Yes, I guess that happens more the older you get. But he's there to tell everybody that Natalie's boss is outside, and this is where we get to meet Robin Givens.
Robin Givens.
I wrote, now coming to the stage, small booty Bonita.
I gotta say, by the way, she held the fuck up. I mean, she is smoking crazy hot.
Looks fantastic.
Mike Tyson fucked that all up. I don't mind saying. He's probably regretting that shit now.
Ooh, too soon? Too soon?
Now, the most important thing that we have to learn about Robin Givens' character here is that she is Black Cruella De Vil.
That's exactly what I said. Miss Alexis is a Disney villain.
Right, right.
See, I'm not creative. I just called her a bitch.
Yeah.
I love, she's like, "I noticed that you didn't clean up your house." And I'm looking around, I'm like, what is not clean about this? There's nothing out of place. It's a set.
And then Natalie moves two pillows from a chair to the couch. That was cleaning up.
I see. Now I've got it all cleaned up. Now, I think we have to emphasize the fact that, okay, so apparently this is her boss. They are having a meeting about her doing her job in her mother's living room.
Why is she at there? This feels like a text message type of situation. or at the place where your business is. Your place of business would be also a good place.
Be the typical.
It's crazy. But yeah, she basically says, you, the single person who I have told to fix the glitch in this computer system, which you, a single human, are designing. If you don't finish it by next week, which honestly, she might as well be like, build that building by next week. Like, that's the task she might get.
I need you to fix that MacGuffin. Well, what if we redesign the MacGuffin? No, that's not going to make sense until Act 3, so don't do that yet. Just fix the MacGuffin.
But if she doesn't do it, she's fired.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, because bosses who want you to do your job are assholes. So, but that's the thing, is that what she's saying to this person is, okay, look, your job is to fix this problem. Now, the fucking movie has no idea what the hell's going on with computers, but just removing that and taking it into the abstract, she's saying your job is to fix X. We have given you months to fix X. You have failed to fix X. And now you're telling me we just need to redesign the entire system, which is like building a whole new fucking car around the paint scratch or something. If you can't do this, you obviously are not capable of doing the job that we hired you to do. You're fired. That is an eminently reasonable, like if Eli shows up and he's like, "Dude, I just don't like to talk anymore, so I'm not going to be talking anymore."
Never a worry. Never a worry.
Yeah, I know. I know Anna was in there going, "Huh? Oh, well, wait, what? How does this work out?" But like, again, like if you can't do the job, you get fired. That's not, "I'm a bad guy" shit. That's a, "I'm a not out of business employer" thing.
Right, and she's supposed to be super evil because of this. I have not had so hard a time deciding who to root for since the Boston bombing.
Oh, God!
I had no idea what no one was torn on that?
Yeah.
No,
it was Boston. Right, yeah. Uh-huh.
Yeah, I mean, in movies are like that. They're just lazy. They don't realize, look, it would probably be more powerful if your boss didn't want to fire you. And she was like sympathetic and said, "You know, I want to keep you, but since this isn't working out, I'm going to have to let you go. That's better than banging on a door, asking for crushed ice in a house that's... Who the fuck has crushed ice? Right. Who has that? Hey, you guys are poor. I don't even want to sit down. But she asked for a can of soda and crushed ice. What are you going to take the time to pour it down the little hole put the crushed ice in?
I'll give you something in the can.
And bitters. I want bitters, too. Like, it's the craziest fucking order.
Two limes.
Salt the glass.
And I gotta say, I think Noah's example of Eli not talking was very unrealistic. It should be more like, if Eli gets a conscience and stops being racist, then I can see why you would kick him the fuck off the show.
Second most likely thing not to happen.
Yeah, that probably is not gonna happen either, right?
I'm happy about the world and I'm gonna be nice to people from now on. Okay, you're fine.
All right, cool. Heath, and you need to stop giving Eli shit. Last week's jokes, I mean, you're not on my best friend list either, you know? You kind of went at black people last week, so just stop giving Eli shit.
I say a lot of things. What did I say last week?
I don't remember, but I remember being like, man, fuck him.
Right, it's all edited
while I was laughing. That asshole.
That's how most people react to our show. They go, fuck that guy.
It's not racist if you were laughing. That's the rule, right?
Oh, I hope so.
It better be.
That's kind of the business model. Yeah, exactly. So, but now here's the great comedy turn in this, but we almost missed a great comedy here, guys. So after Robin Givens comes in and is all bitch going like, hey, you know, if I'm not going to pay you to do your job, if you don't do your job, and it's like, ooh, what a bitch. Uncle E tricks her with a shook up soda. So she gets sprayed
shook up soda
off stage because Robin Givens is like, savage. I am not using two fucking outfits for this. Fuck you guys.
He gives her something in a can and it explodes in her face.
Yeah. There is no question that when Robin Givens signed on for this, they were like, yeah, so it's a 2-day shoot. And she was like, they were like, it's a 1-day shoot. And she was like, they were like, it's a 3.5-hour shoot. And she was like, fine.
If anybody fucks up their lines, keep going. Just keep going.
And I just know when she knew she had to make that sound of her opening a shaken can and pretending it splashed on her, she was like, I'm firing my fucking agent. What is going on? What is going on here? Like,
I feel like someone went to church with Robin Givens and she was like, you know, my church is putting on a play. And Robin Givens was like, oh my gosh, I should totally be a part of it. And then they came in the next week and they were like, here's your script. It's next week. And she was like, no.
You can't rob Jesus, bitch. You better bring your ass.
So now, of course, this is where, like, the family comes in and they're like, oh, you know, how did things go? You know, Mama Jean's all worried about her because, you know, God's cursed her computer system or whatever. I wrote in my notes at this point, did God curse her computer system? I feel like that's where we're going, and that's where we're going, folks.
Yes. Oh, yes, that is where we're going. And she also tells everyone that her boss put her on probation? Right. And, like,
nope.
She didn't use that word.
No mention of probation. We all just watched the scene. You can't trick us. We're the audience.
My boss
just
asked me to do my job. She's unfair.
What a bitch.
Exactly.
Probation doesn't just mean in trouble.
It depends on your race. It really does depend.
Yeah, if I'm put on probation, it's like, we're going to fire you, but we don't want to get sued for some racist shit, so we're going to take our time firing you. This is just a heads up. Start looking for a motherfucking job now.
So, and then, of course, this is where Dad Ass shows back up. I've been missing Stacy. And she's basically here to just remind everybody that if everybody was just going to church all the time, they wouldn't be fucking up and their computer glitches would be just fine and stuff.
Right. And this is also where everyone keeps talking about the natural realm.
Yeah, what?
And I'm like, what is the natural? Everyone here is a weird kind of wizard. Everyone's like, the natural realm is one. I'm like, is this Pathfinder? What system are they using? I don't see any dice.
It's so fucking bizarre. So yeah, but this is the first of many conversations where the good people in this movie are telling another character, no, you need to stop working so hard and taking responsibility for the problems in your life and trust God to just magically fix them.
They're gonna happen soon, I guess. And my note here was, it's Tuesday, I want my goddamn hamburger money. Let's go.
Also, so Stacy leaves and everyone turns to Corey And Corey likes Stacy. Corey has this crush on Stacy. And the answer, and this was baffling. He goes, they're like, oh, you like Stacy? He's like, no. And then Uncle E goes, I've never seen a nose that wide. Question, is a wide nose a sign of attraction?
What the fuck was he talking about?
When you say question, were you asking me?
Ishmael.
Oh, yeah. Yes, so first I gotta say, fuck you for thinking everything in this movie is black. And fuck this movie, because this is actually a black thing.
And, fuck you for saying it, and fuck you for being right.
Yeah, saying you got your nose is wide open. I don't know the origins, but it just means like you're all about a girl. I don't know where that comes from. I even looked for it.
Look, when we go to Fiddler on the Roof, you can ask as many questions.
Well, I'm a big Seinfeld fan, so I got a whole bunch of shit to talk to you about.
What does your penis look like?
But so when I saw your note, the funny thing is, I said, wait, that's a black saying? I thought that was a saying for everybody. And I guess it wasn't. So I Googled it like, oh, wait, where's it? And no one can give me an answer where it's from. But it's just something that, and it just means like you're really into a girl. I don't know the origins. It seems like a weird one. Your nose is wide open. I immediately thought of Coke. And like you being like totally, but that
that'd
doesn't
be a little
mean,
weird,
reaching
but yeah,
by no. trying to do that. It just means you were sprung, and you probably don't even know what sprung mean. I give you,
oh,
I gotta
come
give you
on,
definition
we know what
of the
if,
definition.
If you give it to us in Mix-a-Lot words, of course we know it. Yeah.
Us white people actually do a lot of mouth breathing, so the nose thing doesn't apply. We do more of a.
I like that because that's my favorite phrase: fucking mouth breathing.
It's true. We do that a lot.
So and then, of course, once everybody agrees that Corey's in love with Stacy, but just can't seem to tell her, Dad comes in dying to death.
And he's got chocolate syrup all over his face, guys.
Ketchup all up and down.
And he's got a bandage on his arm already, like a cartoon character, like just broke his wrist. It's like a cast immediately appears.
Well, I assume the loan sharks gave it to him. They were like, all right, no, we need some money by Friday. By the way,
you don't want to get that infected. Yeah, so he was beat up by loan sharks because he took out money to pay the bills when he was sick and thought he was dying last year.
Yeah.
And they are pretending that we are in 1960 because there are other people who rip you off called payday loans and shit
like
that.
Yeah, exactly.
That won't break your legs.
Loan
they
sharks?
Won't, like, beat you. No. Who the fuck is still going to loan sharks? What are you doing? We have legal loan sharks who will fuck you, who will fuck you over and take your house maybe, but they're not going to beat you up.
I don't know. Honestly, given a choice between payday loans and the old school loan sharks who just beat you to death and drowned you.
That's true, because you can leave the state and they're not going
to
go.
Yeah, and they don't try to get you to refinance and shit. Yeah, exactly. So
you can leave the natural realm.
<There you go. laughs> Well, we learn that Daddy's credit is fucked. And at this point, the whole goddamn thing seems like a long creditreport.com commercial. But as if it wasn't bad enough, and I should point out, too, that the Dad also contracted whisper disease from these loan sharks. But as if this isn't bad enough, all of a sudden, they start to sing.
It's a musical. You know, a lot of people think 35 minutes is too long to start the first song in your musical, but no. Not will a man rob God.
I couldn't believe what I was watching. And you know how when you usually watch bad stuff, you almost feel bad for the people. You have like an embarrassed feeling. I hated this movie so much. I was like, good, this is terrible. I'm glad you started singing. Fuck you. You were rude. None of your friends like you now. They're embarrassed for you. Whenever they look at you, they think of this scene. Fuck this movie. How the fuck do you start singing now?
And the song that they're singing, okay, you know why this song works? Is because thank you, Lord, rhymes with thank you, Lord, and you've been so good rhymes with you've been so good. Those are the only lyrics, and they sing that for like 2.5 minutes between the two of them.
To no music. Somewhere backstage, someone rolls around back and forth on a piano, but it's just like, thank you, Lord.
Yep.
That's it. Over and over and over again. And she's like nudging him like, come on, get into it. come on, this is the big dance number before act two. Like, what the fuck?
But he's confused because he's trying to stay in character and be hurt while still singing. So
I wanted the set to fly away and for there to be like chorus girls back there. Thank you. Just trying to dance to three notes.
I wanted chorus girls in cat suits to come out, really bad cat suits. And like, wait, this is musical, right? People in cat suits?
That's what happens in musicals, isn't it? So yes, they have now poured boiling oil into the Iron Maiden, and we have to listen to these fuckers sing. And this is where we, of course, cut to where we've been the whole time, and now it's time for some more comedy with Pookie and Uncle Lee, because Pookie's going to try to win the lottery.
Okay, yeah, okay, right. So just question here. He's naming all the stuff he's got ready to win the lottery. God. He's got his tickets. He's drinking Hennessy out of a plastic lotion bottle, or maybe a urine sample jar. It was one or the other. I feel like I've heard of this in rap songs before. Ishmael, is that a normal black person thing?
Is that why I'm here, for you to keep asking me what the fuck? You better do a Jew movie with you asking Eli every fucking second about banking and fucking hiding gold during the Holocaust and all that. You know, like, come on. No, this movie, they could have literally turned to the audience and been like, hey, can we use a bottle of Hennessy? And like 50 hands would have went up. And they gave them. I can't believe they did that. Like, what are you doing? Jesus. You know the pastor character had a bottle on him. Fuck, yo.
I love too, because there's just, it is this still stupid little comedy moment that they're trying for, where Uncle E is making fun of how gullible Pookie is, and he convinces them that if he walks like a chicken, then his prayers will come true or whatever. And I'm like, okay, this comedy relies on the idea, like the innate, the precept of this joke is that walking like a chicken is inherently stupider than rubbing a lucky rabbit's foot or praying to Jesus. I don't know that I'm buying that.
Yeah, their comedy is, I'm a buffoon. Like, it's really buffoonery. That's like a thing you say, like, they try to make, usually, like, we objected to it because black people would be buffoons in movies and buffoons on stage. And they're, like, embracing it. He's a buffoon. So he's like, well, I forget what he says, God lotto and this lotto and bless this or whatever the fuck he's talking about. And I'm like, why are you doing this to yourself? You are willingly being a buffoon right now. You are making a joke out of yourself. And then the other guy is like, I'm going to make him even more joke and make him like cluck like a chicken. Like, what's going on? Why is anyone thinking that's good in 2013?
This, I imagine being black and watching this movie is how Jews felt watching each other plan 9/11. That's what I'm saying. I think it's the same. Like, it's just like, guys, we don't have to do this. We don't.
But imagine if at the end of Schindler's List, Oscar Schindler, like Hitler comes in and Oscar's like, I saved these ones for you special for those really bad tortures. That's how this movie works, though. That's what we're watching. Anyway, so then, as if this movie wasn't racist enough, now the one financially successful black person shows up. So, and of course, he's not an athlete, so he must be a rapper.
Yeah, and right a now. Drug dealer. You and, can't.
Well,
catch,
that's the
hey,
same
he,
thing.
He deals
though.
Drugs too, because he needs to be both for some reason.
And I want to point out, this is, I'm sure this is just a weird random glitch or whatever, but my Netflix just for no reason pops up and they're like, are you sure you want to continue? Yes, no, at this point in the movie.
We're about to get really
so
racist on your ass.
Yes. Netflix just comes up and just goes, are you still going? Holy shit, bro. You want to take a break? You want to jack off to something or something?
Instead of yes, no, it's like, do you support Trump or don't you? If you support Trump, you're going to keep going.
And it's just, he comes in and so first of all, they're very excited to see him. And then, because this is a musical now, they insist that, they tell us that he used to sing on the corner for change. Mm-hmm.
The rapper drug dealer.
Yeah. And they insist that he sing a song for them. So they do a fucking a cappella number.
Best part of the
and
movie,
he just
in my
sings.
Opinion.
He's clearly a singer with a decent body because he comes in with a tank top and
yeah.
He doesn't rap. He sings. I was like, what am I watching?
Yeah. And by the way, yeah, Jamie, if you're going to send me any tit pics, like his would be fine this week.
Yeah. He made me tickly in my tummy.
He made me want to fight him. I got, you know, hatred issues. You know, I'm very...
Because of the Red Sox hat, right?
Oh, you're mad at the Red Sox hat. And then when I make a Boston bombing joke, you get all tone policing.
Wait, he did have a Red Sox hat?
He had a Red Sox hat. Unbelievable.
I must have blocked that out because I've never met a black dude with a Red Sox hat. Fuck the Red Sox.
Thank you.
What? Yeah. Hey, this is what I said. And then everyone was like, no.
No, he's just this horribly, horribly stereotypical racist character. He might as well have a clock around his neck that says bling spelled out in diamonds. But the Red Sox hat bothered me more than anything.
Oh,
absolutely.
Yeah. Any black guy with a Red Sox or a New England Patriots, like, motherfucker, you are the Clarence Thomas of sports.
Uncle Tom Brady.
Done, sir. And of course, this is where we have to reiterate the whole, like, this millionaire rapper guy keeps trying to give Mama Jean money, but she won't take it because he's a heathen or whatever. But this is also where the rapper dude offers Corey a job. He offers $150,000 for 6 weeks of work. That's $1.3 million a year type salary.
And let me tell you why I love my fiance. The moment he said that, Anna and I simultaneously went, I'll do it. I don't know what that is, but I'll do it.
But she wasn't sure. Talking about the money. She was talking about a black guy's body and everything else that comes with it. She was not talking
I would
about
watch
that,
either
though.
Of those things happen. I'm okay with all of it.
Go D-Money. Yay.
I'll do them. I mean it.
So, of course, but Corey's reaction is to sit there and think, but would Jesus? So he's not 100% sure.
Is it better to stay poor and stupid? Yes. Yep. So I'll stay poor and stupid.
To which D-Money's incredibly casual response is, all right, man, curse God and die. And then just walk.
What?
Like that's a greeting. It's like, all right. I mean, look, if you don't want the money, curse God and die. I'll see you later. Oh, curse God and die. Uncle
he flew all the way from L.A. to wherever the fuck they live now. Or Hollywood, rather. Not even just L.A. Hollywood. And just to be like, oh, you don't want my money, curse. First of all, he comes with no money. Uncle's like, yo, can I have 2 cents? And he's like, oh, all I got's a couple bucks. Motherfucker, if you came to give your mother money, where's the money? What are you talking about? And I don't even know, is he the son? I guess it is because she said I didn't raise him to be that way. I don't know who's related in this fucking
But he
movie.
Said, but he says later that she
he says Mama Jean
raised, yeah,
practically
right.
raised him.
We have no fucking idea. Like, apparently all black people are
so
related.
This movie can't be, if this movie is by a black person, they didn't grow up in around black people, because this sounds so much like a white racist movie where it's like, well, every black person there's a big mama, and first of all, I have no big mama in my fucking family. But they and I actually thought of that early on. Listen, you don't need motherfuckers with fake grays. Make her big mama. That's what black American in movies do for some reason. There's a big mama, and then there's a trickle down of just a bunch of young people who call her mama.
Yeah,
because we're a different breed and we don't have a dad daddy and a mommy, and we have kids and have a loving family. Like, just do that then. And they didn't. So I don't know who this guy is to her.
Yeah.
I thought you guys butted off of Big Mama. I thought it was like
a cyst kind of a
and
thing.
And then you all butt. Yeah.
So, well, it's only if we eat after midnight, and then.
Oh, really. So apparently he turns down the job, you know, whatever, because and the movie thinks that they're making good decisions. But before he leaves, we have to tell him that, you know, hey, I'm coming to your pool party. Rapper millionaire guy Uncle E has to like make sure he's still invited to the pool party and make some jokes about, you know, how he's going to wear his thong because he wouldn't look good in a thong. That's fucking comedy, y'all.
That's so funny.
Yeah. And so he leaves, and they immediately, like, the second he's out the door, they're like, yeah, he's a real motherfucker. And everyone in this movie who leaves the room, 1 second after they're out the room, the other people are talking shit about them loudly. That happens over and over.
It's literally like, have a nice day. And then when they shut the door, I'll slit that motherfucker's throat for $2.
Right, it is. Right, fuck that over and over. He can't possibly be off the front step when they go, man, that money's changed him. He's a real dick now, isn't he?
Yeah, it's a good thing no one ever forgets their keys in this player. They walk back in and be like, that ass motherfucker. Oh,
Yeah, they're right there.
It's all the way on the other side of the room. I'm just going to cross the stage, back.
So they're sitting there going like, I can't believe he said curse God. And he's like, well, he also told you to die. That seemed like that. But I feel like the 150 grand for 6 weeks of work is what we should be focused on here, guys. So now, of course, this is where Natalie comes in looking sad, like nobody's been fingering her asshole while they try to see how many licks it takes to get to the Tootsie Roll center of her clit or anything. Oh, I love me some Natalie.
Allegedly.
I love me some Natalie.
You guys finger assholes? If you're going to deal with the asshole, you got to get pleasure. What are you doing?
We do all kind of stuff with the asshole, man. Basically.
We have very small fingers. It's fine. It's a lot, good to know. Lot more comfortable than you
think. I like
to
yell at it.
So you guys usually thumb the asshole then, right?
We do whatever we go, the best we can.
Yeah, it depends.
You are right, Heath. You do whatever you do, especially when they ain't what. You just have your way and just whatever. Let them deal with the consequences of that.
That is our foreign policy. Yes, sir, it is. So, yeah. So,
finally, call Heath racist. So, take that off my bucket list.
I'm having sex with a black lady here. How am I racist? This is sex. This is very clearly.
I like her. I obviously
multiracial.
Like her.
That makes you more racist. Stay away from my women, motherfucker.
Does it?
Taking a strong anti-race mixing stance here on God.
We're not real big fan of miscegenation.
No, it's okay, but it should be black men fucking white women. Just it goes one way.
Whatever, okay, you're fucking Jewish girls at college.
I told you they didn't allow me to have sex with their...
That's what usually happened to me, but...
Yeah,
I tried.
Yeah, exactly. Exactly like me having sex with black women.
But white Americans, I love... We're just shitting on women. We are terrible men. We're all a bunch of guys talking about, oh, I fuck black women. I fuck Jewish women. I fuck... Jesus.
I thought we were talking about trying to fuck the women and failing. But at any rate, I just want to point out... During this conversation that comes up next in the movie where like Corey and Natalie are talking about, oh, I just don't understand why God would let the wicked prosper or whatever. At one point in this, Corey goes to sit down on the couch. He's up on the arm of the couch. He goes to sit down in it. The cameraman's following him and sneezes. And that stays in the goddamn
it's fucking
movie.
Amazing. So then he gets a phone call, first of all, we have to talk about the phone rings. He answers it by saying, God bless you.
Yes.
Which, by the way, if anyone ever answers the phone when I call them with God bless you, I'm hanging up.
But isn't that because the cameraman sneezed?
It was
because
the cameraman sneezed. Exactly.
Oh, was that why?
Isn't this the scene where the cameraman is seen?
Yes, yes.
I literally wrote, oh my God. I said, I just saw a fucking, I said C because I can't write, a fucking cameraman at 30 minutes and 43 seconds left in the movie. And I saw him. Yeah. And I brought it back and I'm like, why did I see him? Why did someone allow that to happen? That is the easiest cut ever.
Did not give a fuck. If they didn't cut out that bored ass fat 15-year-old girl at the beginning that they cut to in the audience, they weren't cutting out a goddamn thing.
I actually think she was the more slimmer one. I'm not saying she was slim, but she was so, something told me it may have something to do with that. Like everyone else is big as fuck. And she thought
wasn't enough
to bring her here. She's like, wait, I came here just for food. I'm not that hungry. Like fuck all these fat motherfuckers. But yo, when I saw the cameraman, I brought it back and I'm just like, no, I didn't just see a cameraman, and it was some handheld bullshit.
Oh yeah,
like everyone, if we weren't doing a podcast, I would have shut it off. Even if I was Christian, and then in this movie I'd have been like, fuck, you just insulted the shit out of me. You can't cut that motherfucker out.
So nope.
Man.
So, but now they get the phone call, and Corey says God bless you to whoever he's saying that to. And the news on the other line, it's Pookie, and he has to tell him that Mama Jean has collapsed.
Oh okay, but yeah. He was just there like 30 seconds ago.
Yeah.
So apparently he walked outside and just found Mom collapsed right there, yeah. And then called on the phone from the front stoop tell them.
Yes. So in a classic act two ain't over till the old lady drops black drama fashion, we're going to pause for a quick break. But first, let me give act three the hard sell. Will the broke unemployed utilities getting shut off sister still give her money to the pastor? And if she does, will he take it? And if he does, will he turn out to be the bad guy in this movie? And if he isn't, how the fuck could that possibly be? Find out the answer to these first three questions when we return for the jaw-flooring conclusion of Will a Man Rob God?
Please, God, send me money. I need it so very, very badly for things and stuff. Amen.
Send him what he needs.
Hey, man, it's me, your rapper cousin. Do you want a job helping me with my music for $150,000?
Sorry, man. Rap music is bad for some reason or something. God is going to provide.
Okay, curse God and die.
Okay. Please, God, send money. I know you are a good God. I need it so very much. Amen.
Why, hello there. I'm your rich Uncle Albert. Would you like $150 million? I would like to give it to you, $150 million.
I would love that. Thank you so much, Uncle Albert.
All right, wonderful. I'll go get my husband and we can sign the check.
Husband? Sorry, Uncle Albert. No can do.
Seriously?
Yeah.
Okay, well, curse God and die.
All right, curse God and die. Dear God, I super need the money. If there's any way that you could
It's me, Jesus of Nazareth. He with $1 million in unmarked bills. Just take it right now. Take it. Here.
Oh, Jesus. You're Jewish, right?
And we're back for more breakdown, and we'll start in the only set this movie has, where Natalie clearly needs me to fantasize about determining what does and doesn't fit some more, when all of a sudden Pastor Sims comes a-knockin'.
Yes, and Pastor Sims is here to check on her mom for, I would say, anywhere between 5 and 7 seconds before he starts to talk about money.
Yeah.
And Pastor Sims definitely likes the way he looks, I would say.
He's quite happy.
And I actually think the pastor was written as, even though it's subtext, he actually didn't go to the hospital and didn't give a shit about the mom and just came to talk about money.
Yeah.
Because he just talked about it and was like, anyway,
it sure seems like it. Yeah, he makes it about 3 sentences in. He's like, anyways, enough of your dying mom. So, like, how you doing with money? Are you robbing God? Are you a God robber? Just out of curiosity. Just like wondering.
Well, right.
Check if you decided to be a God robber all of a sudden.
And of course, this is where we learn that, you know, Natalie lost her job because she couldn't fix the computer glitch, and she's down, and like all of the bills are past due and everything. And again, the pastor's just like, oh, well, you know, if you guys want to come in and sign that form I was telling you about weeks ago before you have this problem, you can still do that.
But he didn't even say you guys. He said you. And I immediately was like, there's going to be a scene with him fucking her. But because it's this movie, it's going to somehow be in the house. I don't know how that goes to be coming down, but somehow.
That's what they use the kitchen for, I guess.
Because he totally was like, come down tomorrow and I'll give you that money, baby girl. Don't worry about it. I got you.
Yeah, we make all of our donations rain down on top of our parishioners. This is pretty normal.
That's how it goes. Now, and of course, this is where you start to really get the first hint in this movie that this movie is pro prosperity gospel, because this is where Pastor Sims is, you know, because the girl's like, I just don't understand why people don't like our church and everything. And he's like, well, we face extra persecution because of the prosperity gospel. It looks so much like complete bullshit to people that I'm just empowering and enriching myself. That's why they persecute us so much.
Right. And then the pastor says, yeah, well, prosperity is the most confusing part of the Bible. And I wrote, is it really? Is it? Everything else in that book makes more intuitive sense than the prosperity part. Have you read it? No, they have not.
He also says that prosperity is just as important as salvation.
Yep.
Yeah. I forget the part where Jesus was going to check your 401ks, and if they weren't in the right position, he was going to throw you into a lake of fire. But I sped red.
I totally felt like he should have said prosperity is the most confusing thing. Now that we live in a capitalist society and it makes no fucking sense
For
you to just be giving your money to people.
It's goddamn insane. And it's so bad, like, because when they start talking about, well, prosperity is written all over the Bible from Genesis to Revelation, I'm like, we're supposed to be booing right now, right? The audience is supposed to throw tomatoes like in fucking Rocky Horror Picture Show
because he's been the bad guy. Yes.
Yeah. Right.
Because then She takes money out of her purse. She is just told, he's just visited her mother in the hospital. She's just told him she's lost her job. She has unpaid bills. She's in a huge financial bad situation. She takes money out of his purse and gives it to him. And Noah, do you want to tell us what happens? Because you've written in about 800 font here.
Yes, I had to go to fucking 64 point type for this. So she says, I know I don't have much money, but here's my tithe. Now 10%, that's supposed to be 10% of your earnings. If you're not earning anything, you don't tithe. But at any rate, zero. Here's my tithe. And he fucking takes it. They don't have him say yep. in the movie, no, I can't take this from you. You need this more than God does since I drive a Bentley. He fucking takes it. He says, I know this is hard for you to give to me and it's hard for me to take, but you need me to multiply this fucking money. She says, well, I believe that you're doing what's right with my seed, to which I wrote, definitely not the Eli Bosnick story. And he puts her goddamn money in his pocket and says, you need me to multiply this for you.
And he just a moment ago said he's going to give her money the next day. She's handing him cash so
yes.
he can give it back tomorrow. Like, but no, he's going to multiply it for her. He says like a compound interest prayer and whatever. 900% compounded daily.
Well, right. First of all, what they should have done, if you want to not make the pastor look like a piece of shit, have her give it to him with him not knowing she lost her job and other things.
Right.
And then maybe he can say something about, well, this money you gave me means even more now because God knows you don't. There's so many ways to not make him look like a
scumbag. Just have her not
it's
give
so
him money.
Easy to do.
Why don't you, how about just leave that part out? Not have her hand him money.
How about have him just give her money? Just give her money.
That would work.
I can't get groceries today. Here is fucking $50. Go get groceries.
I think you guys are missing out on a big opportunity here. We need to start a blowjob prosperity ministry. Huh?
Don't we?
If you give me a blowjob, God is going to give you 900 blowjobs down the road.
Have we not been doing? I thought we had a
thing. We're just right. not. We haven't set up the. We haven't incorporated.
We haven't codified it.
Yeah, exactly. So, yeah, and so then Pastor Sims leaves because he's got her money now. That's the other thing is that he takes her money and runs. It's like, oh, I got your money now. Well, hope everything's okay with Mom. I'm out. And then right. Corey shows up to tell him that Mom's doing good. Now, I also want to just go back to this for a second. Like, Mom collapsed at the end of Act 2 because something dramatic needed to happen in Act 2. There is never a way in which this advances the story. We never get told what was wrong with her. She's fine later. No one has an epiphany because she's collapsed. They just needed a dramatic ending for Act 2.
Yes. Why do black moms always collapse in movies? Oh,
I don't get
fucking,
it.
What are they? Big mamas.
Well, that was my question for you. So now nobody knows.
But shut up.
Corey,
I actually have a confession. I'm not even black American. My family's West Indian. So I didn't grow up with, as you asked before, chicken. What was it? Pig feet or
pig
some
feet,
stupid
yeah.
shit? I'm West Indian.
I didn't
so
ask
fuck
about the
you
pig
and
feet.
All that. So I actually came in undercover as a black American. You guys thought you were getting a genuine black American. Thing,
well, fuck. I grew up in Detroit. I think I'm blacker than Ishmael.
Exactly. Oh,
guys, I got to scratch how many black friends we have off the whiteboard.
Back to zero.
Yeah. Fine. You have no black friends. Come on, stop playing.
I was going to say, you kind of had to assume after we made Ishmael watch this movie, it was going back to zero.
Yeah, exactly. I'm not talking to you guys again. I'm going to be I'm a shit talking online motherfucker, especially with podcasters. So I'm going to give it to you guys, especially Heath, because he's not saying things that I think he would be saying if I wasn't here.
Right. He's editing this week's show, so he's just going to sub right? him in, and you'll be like, he did not call me that when I was on the Skype call. He did not.
He called this an affirmative action show in his notes. He's like, okay, I'm going to give this guy a pass, let him be funnier than me today, and, you know, whatever, and go back to normal tomorrow.
So now, meanwhile, back in the film we're reviewing, Corey has decided to take that job with D money, that $150,000 for 6 weeks. There is nothing I would not do for 6 weeks for $150,000. And I do mean that. But he's decided to take this job now, but he's all conflicted about it because of the heathenish drug nature of it.
Everybody tweet us with ideas for Noah to do stuff for 6 weeks. Just throwing it out there.
He makes it seem like, like he has to go murder someone. Like he's just so, I'm selling my soul to Satan. I'm
I'm going to go suck cocks at the glory hole for money, guys.
Exactly,
sorry.
Exactly. Right. I'm going to go join Big Booty Brenda.
And she is horrified that he is going to be a music promoter. She might as well call him a thug and explain that he, you know, he should have raised his hands quicker or whatever it is. She hates him for this. And he says to her, he's like, mom's sick. I can't afford not to do this. And it's like he's going, honestly, I thought this movie was going to end up with like him killing someone for money or him robbing a church or something, you know, doing something super terrible that we'd be like, oh, that's why a man would rob God. But no, it's just taking a job in the secular world is the worst thing a character does in this movie.
Yep.
The way he made it seem was as if his brother or whatever the fuck the gangster name is actually isn't a famous rapper and he's being paid to go to the hospital and murder his mother. Like that's how we made it seem.
That's the performance he delivers. Yes.
And then they're going to get the life insurance and be on top of
the hire Woody Harrelson to do it or something. So then he leaves and Natalie drops to her knees just like she does in My Fantasy. She calls me father too. But unfortunately, no, never mind. She's praying and crying. So, you know, bingo at least.
Praying, crying montage. Christian movie bingo.
Yeah, right. And my music note for this prayer, by the way, is the piano bar guy is trying to get that last chick there depressed enough to fuck him.
My music note is an orphan is hacking out tiny little cocks.
Right, yeah.
And my music note is, and this goes with all the singing, the one song that made us think we were going to see a musical. But like, did you guys not like do, put it over the movie in post?
No.
Like,
nope.
Are we really listening to you guys on stage singing? What is going on?
Yep.
Oh, yes.
I just wrote, somebody get Billy Joel another scotch or he's going to hang himself on stage. This is depressing. Yes.
And just as she's begging Machina to do the X, the Deus Ex Machina shows up. It's Robin Givens at the door.
Yeah.
Because she's found the glitch in the system and repaired it, even though she was fired.
And at the same time, they fired her and clearly didn't hire anyone else. They just was like, well, if we can't repair it, fuck us.
Yeah. I fixed the MacGuffin. It's Act 3. You said it would make sense now. So I did it.
And I just want to point out that what we have here is we have a gorgeous and fragile young woman and a still smoking hot middle-aged Robin Givens, and one of them needs her job back really, really bad. So I'm lubing up. I'm like, okay, it was worth the hour worth of setup so far. No.
Also, by the way, Robin Givens, her front teeth got gappier throughout this movie. I don't know how that happened, but I like it.
I think she got back with Mike Tyson.
Maybe a little Michael Strahan in there too,
maybe.
It's a good look.
So Natalie has now redesigned the system in her spare time. And I love the moment where, and this really speaks to Heath's best words, where Robin Givens is checking the computer to make sure that the glitch is gone.
It's amazing.
By pounding repeatedly on the same key.
I wanted so bad to see what the screen actually says there. Like, just glitchless computer program. Perfect. You did it. Well, excellent.
Here's what's amazing. They turn and there's a reverse shot and you can very clearly see it's just the entry screen to a window.
Yes, it is.
It's
it
the
is.
Windows login screen. Yes.
They don't even have the login information for that computer, clearly.
No. Right. So apparently Natalie's going to hand over the Windows 95 repair CD to fix the glitch. Yeah. That's the
well,
plot here.
That's because computer words, data, RAM, microchip, USB, you see. So, now she's fixed the computer program, but she doesn't just want her job back. She wants the big money. That's actually the word she says. She wants in on the big money.
Mm-hmm. She should have said the white money. Now, I don't want this nigger money you're trying to get.
I want white people money.
Can I laugh at that?
Yeah, you just can't replete it. You can't play it. You have to let me play this part. part of the podcast.
Yeah, exactly. When you edit it, you have to bring in a black man to do that portion of the edit, Heath.
So. Do not edit that, Noah. I have to edit that part.
See, this is the thing. She learns that they were going to sell the system to Microsoft for $30 million. Mm-hmm. And she wants this employee who is just part of the, this is like a random coder, we can assume, who's fixing a glitch in the system, would like $15 million.
Yeah.
Which, to be fair, Robin Givens reacts to realistically. She's like, you don't just get to have half of a company contract.
Yeah, so apparently she's just going to go fucking sell it to Bill Gates Girl Scout style.
She's Hello? Just going to cold call Bill Gates. Yeah. Yeah. I have this thing called Windows 11. You want to check it out? I'm just going to come by the office. Cool.
And this scene set up so much of Robin Givens murdering her. It's like, oh, this is worth $30 million, and all I need to do is leave the house with this computer. You're dead. There's no yeah, one else here. Right. I am murdering you, and it would cost me less to get off.
I've with done worse you. Than this just for a Dalmatian jacket, bitch.
Right. And they're acting like the fix, the key to fixing Microsoft Windows is physically located inside yeah. this Commodore laptop she has and nowhere else.
Right, they're exactly. fighting over the
She laptop. Actually fixed it already, so shouldn't Robin Givens be like, bitch, you already fixed it. Have a good day.
It's on the cloud.
Exactly. I went on GitHub and I have it now. It's fine. You get nothing.
And I just have to say, because we talked about this earlier, she says, I called this meeting.
Yes.
As they're at her house.
In her living room.
Right. You're probably wondering why I asked you here today.
Robin Givens should have been like, to eat my pussy to get your job back? Why else would I be in your
yes,
home?
Yes, she definitely should have said that.
And you call me to your house, start licking.
That's why I asked my Uncle E to sit in, actually.
So, cool. Like, next time I smoke a bowl with my wife, and be like, you might be wondering why I called this meeting here. In the fuck is she talking about? So anyway, so Robin Givens, Uncle E comes in. By the way, his bowels seem to be doing much better since that opening scene. He comes in, or comes out from the back or whatever, where he was jerking off just as she's leaving. And this is where Natalie, the flat broke, unemployed daughter, calls her lawyer.
Her lawyer.
Yes.
Now look, I'm no too. Legal expert, so once this episode comes back, I'll run it past Andrew Torres, but I'm pretty sure your lawyer doesn't give you a connection to Microsoft and also make sure that there's nothing illegal about taking a program that was at your old job, creating it for yourself, and selling it out from under them. I mean, I'm not sure. We'll wait and see. Maybe he'll do a segment on Atheistically Speaking.
That, how does she have a lawyer? Like, what are you doing with a lawyer? What's
Look,
going
she
on?
She can't
here?
Pay the power bill, but you gotta pay your lawyer. She's got her priorities.
And
there.
How does the lawyer already know what happened with the glitch fixing thing? How does she calls him and he's like, oh yeah, I already talked to Microsoft. They want it. Yeah. We're gonna get you like $30 million. What?
Yeah. He's one of those lawyers that sets up meetings with Microsoft for your computer. What the how she might as well have just said, well, gotta call my shaman.
Right. She should have said her priest. It would have fit with the stupid yeah,
right,
movie.
Right, if Pastor Sims set it all up. Yeah, exactly. So she's all excited because she's going off to meet Microsoft about her program. She's going to meet Microsoft. That's a guy, Ted Microsoft. He's the one who owns it. And then Uncle E orders some porn with a number that he has memorized. So. Right.
And we're going to watch him jerk off until the black. I was like, we are going to watch Uncle E jerk off.
When was the last time porn resorted by phone?
Yeah, wait,
yeah,
what?
What year is this? This is 2013. Who orders pay-per-view porn on the phone?
Even that 1997 yeah. Dell she was running could have showed yeah. him porn, yeah.
And even if you do that, why would you order Fat Girls Who Like Walks on the Beach Part 2? That's a crazy choice.
Yeah, it's totally derivative. It's not even close
to the sequel
to
was terrible.
Yeah, it wasn't even good.
The sequel was awful.
We had like three people from the original movie, and I don't want to get into it. I don't want to get into it. This show's political enough as it is, but I'm just saying.
I still want it back from you.
So now
loaned it to you.
We cut to the next scene where this is more comedy from Uncle E and Pookie. They're going to the pool party. Now, I have to point this out just because the writer in me won't let me run by this. Okay, so we've set up this pool party. They talked earlier about going to the pool party at D-Money's. D-Money showed up and they talk about the pool party then. Now we see them getting ready to go to the pool party. The pool party will have nothing to do with anything in this movie.
Nope. It won't take place during the timeline of this movie.
It will not even happen. Yeah.
That's it.
It is because it's their comedy skits. That's what it is. That's why it's in
so that Pookie can walk out in a duck inner tube and a fucking snorkel on his way to the pool party. Right. Yeah.
And by the way, here's what Uncle E is setting up to go to the pool party.
Oh, yes, by all means.
Extra towels, sunblock, and Viagra, which is exactly what I would use to watch porn with my nephew, but maybe not to, I mean.
And at one point, okay, so Pookie comes out and he's wearing floaties on his arm and three inner tubes and everything because he's afraid of the water, and it's hilarious. And just in, so you know how deep into the barrel they have gone for their comedy, Pookie makes a Howard the Duck joke. You guys remember Howard the Duck? Of fucking course you don't! Why would anyone remember Howard the Duck? As a nation, as a species, we've tried to exercise that fucking memory. Why would you make a joke about it? Anyway.
Can I say something? And this is one of the moments you probably should ask me. Black people remember Howard the Duck.
Why?
We also remember Teen Witch. Teen Witch is another classic that I watch yearly.
Do you not get Today TV? Do they make you only watch
Teen
a certain...
Teen Witch and Howard the Duck is our version of GAM. It's watching white people act poorly in shitty movies, and it's entertaining as fuck. She fucks a duck, or she's about to fuck a duck.
She gets really close to fucking a duck.
Of course I remember that.
Yeah, I do remember that. I do remember that, yeah.
But I just want to point out, the reason why we have this scene where he's all covered in floaties and stuff is because we have hit every racist trope about black people except for they can't swim.
Yes.
So we needed to get that in there at the end. Whatever bet this guy made with a Hollywood screenwriter, he just sniffed something off this script and he was like, I can make every offensive thing about black people in a single script and no one will call it racist. And he was like, you got a deal, man. Do a line off my dick.
This writer, and listen, I'm going to be honest. I live in L.A. I've worked in Hollywood for a while. I've actually done some rewrites on some decent, like the guy who wrote Point Break and Varsity Blues, whatever. He's a terrible writer, but he gets good rewrites. So anyway, he's writing this movie for Samuel Jackson, and it's about a LeBron James type of basketball player. And he asked me to, his manager asked me to read it and to, like give him feedback. And he basically wants me to change slang, and he wants me to make it seem like it's written by a black person.
Black it up.
It is the most racist, insulting thing. And I had to say gently to him, you don't seem to like your characters. You have fried chicken jokes in this. You have jokes. You don't want me to like your main characters. And it's funny because he introduced me to Sam Jackson, and he's like, hey, I got him going over that script for you. So obviously Sam Jackson read it. Sam Jackson looks at me and he goes, did he just tell me he's blackening up my script? And I swear that's what happened in this fucking film.
Yeah.
This was written by some racist white guy, and then some black guy came in and kind of, because these are all tropes black people are clearly insulted by.
I would hope so. I would certainly fucking hope so. Yeah.
I don't know. The audience seemed to be enjoying it, guys. I think you might be getting a little.
That bothers me most. That bothers me most. And I'm not surprised because there are certain people within the community who will find this funny. And you want to tell a motherfucker you should be insulted by that. What are you laughing for? Right.
But we need to wrap up the romance element of this movie, guys.
Oh my God. The, hey, how's it going? I clearly like you. That one?
The element that doesn't exist yet that they're going to wrap up now? Yeah.
Yeah, perfect. Yeah, exactly. So, yeah, so Stacy shows up, and of course, Corey, last time we saw him, was all conflicted about the job that he took where he's making fucking $1.3 million a year, or at least that pace. And so apparently he's quit that job now so that he can be broke and work 90 hours a week for cocaine money or whatever. And Stacy's very proud of him. She wants him to know that she's real happy about that and that Jesus is still Lord.
Right. This is the quote. Jesus is still, how's church? She goes, well, you know, Jesus is still Lord. You know that still, right? And he's like, oh, yeah, of course. Jesus. Sure. Yeah. Pop quiz.
So yeah. So, and then this is where he like tells her, you know, like, hey, I've never told you this, but the reason I joined that church in the first place is because you were at that church. So I've kind of been stalking the shit out of you for years, Stacey. I hope you find that romantic.
Yeah. It was so creepy the way he says it. It's like, yeah. What I'm trying to say is, I'm going to rape you. Wait, no, that came out wrong. You start over. I'm going to rape you. Fuck!
Right. He basically says, I've got everything I want. My life, my Lord, my woman. And it's like, you just told her you liked her.
Exactly.
You are not. You are dating at her.
She is. Yeah, right. She has not right. responded.
How is she yours? Yeah. How is she yours?
It's biblical. She doesn't get a say.
Like, and I got to say, we didn't talk about it, but the way they hinted that they liked each other, or at least he liked her, he'd go, bye, Stacey. And then they'd be like, and we did that whole nose wide open bullshit. But, like, I don't get, like, who wrote, like, that guy, Eddie Wynn, well, he did act in Family Matters, and that's how Urkel acted. So maybe that does, cause when he read it, I'm like, aren't you adults? Don't you know if you like someone, you don't need to go, like, who does that? Bye, Stacey. Like, what? That seems like you're going to rape and murder her later.
Yeah.
Like, that's what it sounded to me.
Yeah, Stacey's putting lotion in the basket later.
Yeah, well, apparently exactly. Eddie Winslow already put 50 shekels down on her, so at this point, it's just bound to happen. And now, of course, Mama Jean and Daddy come in, where my notes are just like, whose fucking house is this? Who does and does not live here? Because they said they were going to help Mama Jean with her groceries when they found her collapsed. Like, where the... anyway, yeah. So... And also, as if to just prove Ishmael's earlier point about how they didn't actually write lines for Pookie, they just expected him to be funny. At this point, he's like, they're like, oh, you're dressed very nice. He's like, yeah, I thought I would get a job because everybody had been getting a job in this movie. And then, like, I was like, yeah, okay. And then they just carry us like, what the fuck was the point of that?
Was that his turn to talk? He was like, I was promised a third of every scene, motherfucker.
No reason for that.
Fucking insane.
And but this is also where we learn that, like, Natalie calls to tell everybody to just hang out there. She's got a big announcement to make.
Why do they need that? They don't need that. She's gonna walk in 30 seconds.
Right?
She's calling from the fucking
this
driveway.
Kills me.
This kills. What? Who? Why? The question that writer answered was, why doesn't everyone leave the room? Just keep them in the room talking and have her walk in. It's baffling. Everything about this script is
baffling. No, the only thing that happens between them announcing that she's going to show up and her showing up is Pastor Sim showing up. So Pastor Sim showing up could have been the reason they were in the room.
Pastor Sims walks in without asking, and then they go, what are you doing here? And he goes, that's what happens when you leave your door open. And I wrote the Eli Bosnick story. But he just wanders in without permission.
Yep. That's how he rolls.
Shot in the chest.
Yeah, stand your fucking ground.
You should have picked the wrong house, and it was some white person's house. And I'm picketing for a fucking prosperity gospel pastor.
Right. And then Nancy comes in, or Stacy. Nancy comes in.
Natalie.
Nancy is the unblackest name ever.
No black Nancy.
Nancy is nobody in this movie. Also. Nancy.
Yeah. Is there Nancy? There's one of them's Nancy?
No. Natalie.
Natalie.
Yeah.
Natalie comes in. It's fucking impossible. It's fucking impossible. Natalie comes in. Who knows at what time or what character she is at this point? All of those things could have changed. But she comes in and she's like, hey, you remember that thing that was very clearly established and revealed in three scenes ago? That thing. And everyone's like, $30 million.
Well, right.
So she's gotten $30 million. This woman alone has gotten $30 million from Microsoft for her computer system.
Well, now, to
because
be fair,
she fixed the program.
Well, right, but because this happens to prosperity gospel congregants constantly. They are constantly coming into $30 million from their computer datas. So, mm-hmm. Yeah.
Right. And she's going to give the church $3 million.
She said she turns right.
She said the first 10% goes to the... This is when I said, oh, this is actually this movie's for prosperity gospel.
Yeah, that's where
I was blown away in this scene.
I know, but I'm with you all the way to this moment. I was certain that this was going to turn around, and it was going to turn out that the old black church, the Southern Baptist church or whatever, was the good church. And but no, this is where we learn that yes, he sent off the fucking goddamn chain letter or whatever, so he didn't get driven over by the cement truck. That's actually how they end the goddamn movie, because she gave money to the fucking church when she could not afford to. She got $30 million. That's the message of this movie.
You want
to
know what's scary is that the people who were helping her stay afloat, which was her mom who was at the other church, bad shit happened to her, happened to her husband. Mm-hmm. It's almost like, see, now you look back at it and you're like, oh shit, because they weren't prosperity gospel, God was like killing them basically. Mama fell down and the other dude got beat up.
Cursed.
Jesus.
Cursed.
Yeah, exactly. They're cursed with the curse.
It was the pastor. Like in a whole Kaiser Soze kind of twist, the person that the father owed money to should have been the pastor. He was
fucking him. This whole movie, everything starts to go bad in this movie like ham. You just watch it and just everything turns absurd. It's like the fucking Dali film where people are cutting their eyes open.
Yeah.
Like if Natalie had opened her mouth wide and her jaw just dropped to the floor, and then Robin Givens had walked out as a baby and been like, give me back my crushed eyes, I would have been like, sure, I get it.
Why the fuck not?
Makes as much sense as everything else in this movie.
And then the pastor takes credit for all of it, of course, because that's what pastors do. And just when we thought the credits were going to come up and leave the only respectable, likable character in this movie not Christian, Uncle Lee decides that he's ready to be saved, because otherwise he won't be in the will of his suddenly rich niece or daughter.
Yes.
Or whoever the fuck she is to him.
Freeze frame. Literal freeze frame.
Yep. Yep.
Oh my, he is the least likely to ever convert. Like, if they did one good thing in this film, he definitely does not seem like he's Christian at all or will ever be Christian, and then they made him Christian.
Well, but I still feel like we can just buy our way out of that by saying he faked it to get in good with Natalie now that she's a gazillionaire.
Yeah, that's true. That's
so
true.
That's what I'm going with, because I want to like Uncle E. Yeah,
I would do that as well.
Yeah, right. I wouldn't blame you even a little bit. So I feel like this is a stupid question, having made it all the way through the movie, but will a man rob God? I feel like they're saying yes, no, yes.
I think yes until he puts your mama and your daddy in the hospital.
Oh, right. So the answer to that question is yes, and God will fuck you up.
Exactly.
I still pass. No idea.
Whatever, Heath. No one's buying it. We know who you really are.
Now, obviously, I'm not going to ask you how many stars you would give this movie, because you'd give it one, but over time, God would multiply that again and again, and we just can't risk that shit. So rather than offer it up a numerical scale, I ask you this. What is the most damaging message you could send to a financially underprivileged and educationally underserved minority that would still be less damaging than the message of this movie?
I got this. White people are your friend.
Ooh, mine was close to that. Vote for Jill Stein.
I was going to say, check out Florida. It's really nice there.
Bright, sunny.
You have to wait for another shooting. Has Eli taught you nothing?
No, it's good, because there's, because remember the guy with he had all the things your racist uncle wanted him to do, and then they still shot him because they were aiming for the other guy who they shouldn't have been shooting at? It's okay now. It's okay.
Oh, I see. Well, Ishmael, congratulations. The suffering Christ has nothing on you now. You made it all the way through. But of course, our listeners might not be done with you yet. So if they'd like to hear more from you, more anger, more rants, more blackness, where should they go?
They should go to Angry Black Rant, basically across the board. Facebook, Angry Black Rant. Twitter, Angry Black Rant. And you can find a podcast where you find podcasts under Angry Black Rant.
All right. Well, I appreciate you keeping it simple for the white folks. And of course, we'll have all that linked on the show notes for this episode. Ishmael, thanks again for hanging out.
Thank you for having me. It's been a friggin' blast. I loved it, man. Absolutely loved it.
And by the way, who won in the Black
Ooh.
Friend competition?
Oh, see, Heath's a big phony. I think Heath is like, he wants to lynch me, because he was going out his way to not say shit. And they scare me the most. They scare me. Like, he's cool until I show interest in, like, his sister or some other white girl. And then he's like, how dare you, you big black. Anyway. But also, Eli has shown himself. So you won.
I knew obviously. I would.
Oh.
I'm from Detroit. I had an unfair
or
advantage.
Or I won, depending on how you look at
yeah.
it.
Oh, shit.
Depending on if you send some cops to my house and then...
Yeah, depending on what he edits your words to sound like by the end of it. And, well, that does it for our review of Will a Man Rob God? That's not going to do it for the episode just yet, because we still need to make you want to shout for next week's show. So, Eli, tell us, what's on deck?
Day When Sun Rises in the West, film that will shock the world.
I thought it was film that will shock world.
Yeah. It's a Muslim apocalypse movie about that camel... elephant lion
really
thing
is.
With Bollywood special effects and subtitles oh. that can best be described as occasional. It's on YouTube, but it looks pretty fucking great.
Oh my god. Was there a preview? I couldn't find a preview.
There
I
is
just,
no
I just,
preview. I have no okay. idea.
I just flipped around through the movie. It looks ridiculous 5 seconds at a time. So
holy shit. Yeah, like I watched like 3 clips of it or whatever. Every time people were in front of a green screen when they really shouldn't have been, you know, when the background is just like tree
yeah.
or something like that. So,
green screened a lot of rooms for this.
Exactly. You just see that. I'm sure at one point they were green screening over what was it behind them in the room. Room, you know, hey, move the green screen. I got to get this for the green screen. Anyway, so with that to look forward to, we'll bring episode 49 to a merciful close. Once again, a huge thanks to Ishmael of the Angry Black Rant podcast for suffering alongside us today, and a perhaps even huger thanks to all the Patreon donors that helped make the show go. If you'd like to count yourself among their ranks, you can make a per episode donation at patreon.com/godawful and thereby earn early access to every episode. You can also help us out a ton by leaving us a 5-star review on iTunes and by sharing the show on all your various social media platforms. And if you enjoy the show, be sure to check out our sibling shows, The Scathing Atheist and The Skeptocrat, available on iTunes, Stitcher, and wherever else podcasts live. If you have questions, comments, or cinematic suggestions, you can email godawfulmovies@gmail.com. All the music used in this episode was written and performed by Ryan Slotnick of Evil Giraffes on Mars and was used with permission. If you like what you hear more by following the link on the show notes for this episode. Thanks again for giving us a chunk of your life this week. For Heath Enright and Eli Bosnick, I'm No Illusions, promising to work hard to earn another chunk next week. Until then, we'll leave you with the Breakfast Club close.
We love the God, Lord.
Thank you.
God. The
thank
day.
You.
Natalie unplugged the router for 10 seconds and saved the Microsoft Corporation.
Uncle E shit in the pool.
If Pookie had just followed instructions, he would still be alive today. That's an All Think headline. I'm just reading right off. I'm reading it off how All Think. That's not on me.
Thank you.
Thank God.
Thank you.
Billy Joel's going to kill himself.
I do not trust white people who are nice to me.